Hey, let us go ahead and get ourselves started for today. Thank you for joining us for our second live session of the 120A220A series. For folks who aren't here or are good watching it remotely, let's just explain that these are just optional sessions to help out with kind of supplementing what's available on the videos. The videos cover an awful lot of the kind of tactical stuff you need to do in terms of working with the tools. But you know, there's a lot of value in sharing and kind of just seeing what other people are working on and kind of commiserating and experiencing it all together. So the idea is to really use these sessions really as, in some ways it's kind of like office hours, but with a little more structure to it in terms of just sharing different problems people are having and answering questions. And today, what I was thinking about doing was actually looking at some of the things going on with the first assignment and really how you transition from your initial building models to something that starts, you know, having annotations, dimensions, and tags and things to actually get it on sheets and get it ready to all turn in, stuff like that. So I think a lot of people have started making some progress. If not, I think it's actually a fairly easy assignment in terms of getting going. It's, you know, this little 500 square foot like a research center, like a little research station to be located out of Jasper Ridge. So it's not too bad as a overall kind of building, but we'll take a look at that. Just talk about logistics. Really, this session could be whatever you want it to be, which is good because you know, hey, it's like it's custom education, exactly what you like. Just to help me get started, even help me with names again, because I see Amir in another class, but just so I'm calling people the right names. And your name is again?
Bianca.
Okay, yours Bianca.
Bruna.
And Bruna. Very good. Excellent. Okay. Got the bees. Okay, very good. And Amir is here. And there are several of us who might be joining at various points in terms of trying to set up this time. This was kind of the best overall window for people, but let me ask you guys in terms of the ones that are here. Like, you're able to come at 11. Can you stay till like noon or 1? Or how late can you stay before you go off to another class? What's that?
Noon.
Noonish? I can't have a few.
Till 1.
Okay, you're good. And Amir, how are you?
12:15.
Okay, so we'll do as much as we can in the first hour, and then some people will continue, and other people won't. And I think other people will join in. It's just a little bit of a mix in terms of all that type stuff. Great. So let's go ahead and just start out with some of the real basics in terms of just logistics to help you kind of understand how we get it organized. Okay, in terms of how we approach logistics, there's a couple different ways, you know, things you need to know about. In terms of us all working together, I'm part of the teaching team, but also we have Afalabi, Gustavo, and Nikos, who've all taken many of the different classes in the series. They're all kind of available through the Canvas system, but I'll send out a message specifically with their emails and stuff like that. So, you know, there's really a lot of help potentially available. And typically what's been happening in just for general office hours, so you guys know, every week what's been happening is just for the other classes, we've been pretty much in here on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I would say. In the late afternoons. So I've been trying to sort of work out a pattern where we stay here. I have class up till about 3:30, but from 3:30 to say 7 p.m., we're just kind of generally here. And the type of office hours we have, sometimes we have scheduled appointments where we sit there and meet with a specific person on their project, but it's pretty much just open hours. Come on in, and you know, usually if there's a lot of people, we'll put our name on the board and just kind of take it first come, first serve. But also just even as we're working through the appointments, there's a lot of times, there's little questions you can ask that are enough to kind of get you going and stuff like that. So know that's always available to you. So you can always just stop by on Tuesdays or Thursday afternoons. We're just pretty much always in here. Our teaching team is also available pretty much whenever you need them. In terms of a communication method, I'd like to sort of set up a way that we can all talk together and you can sort of post questions, get anyone to answer them, because who knows who will have the answer quickest for you, or you might even be able to help each other out. So I've used Piazza for this in the past. I've used Slack for this. Do you guys have a preference? Are you on Piazza for any other classes? Okay, so is that a good one for you? Like, do you check Piazza in terms of looking for things, for other things? Okay, because if that does, then I could just set up our class that way too.
What is Slack?
Oh, Slack is just another, it's kind of like an instant messaging system that a lot of people in business use, but I think it's like Twitter where you have channels that are associated with a specific class.
Okay.
So, but I don't know, if Piazza's working for you, that's okay. So, does that work for you too? Okay, excellent, let's kind of think, okay. So I'll go ahead and set up our channel that way. I'm gonna give you a way to do it. We'll do it this way. I guess I can invite you to that. Super. I'm going to go through and update the assignment schedule. The assignments are all sort of hanging around there to really be done at any time, but it's helpful to kind of have them mapped out approximately in some sort of order, so you have some target dates to work on. We'll go ahead and update that. As at this point, just so you know, no one's turned in assignment one yet, so we're all sort of in the same boat. No one should worry about like being behind. You can't kind of catch up. Generally what happens, well, I was almost sort of explaining to Bianca.
Yes. Right,
okay, and versus Bruna. This is, it's the two B names are gonna get me a little mapped up or messed up a little bit. Yeah, the first assignment really kind of stands alone. The first one is really the field research station. And that's really more just kind of getting yourself all warmed up. And just getting a first experience with putting some things together and getting a model onto sheets. Two and three actually work together, just so you sort of know about that. It's this little vacation house. And in two, what you end up doing is modeling sort of a two-story structure, putting in stairways and railings and things like that. In three, what you do is you take that same structure and you render it. So you apply materials and lighting and create visualizations, you know, walkthroughs or camera views and things like that. So they kind of work together just as you start planning ahead. Just, you know, two and three are really kind of extensions of the same excitement. Four and five are actually same assignment, just kind of mapped out that way. Four and five are really all about what I call an engineering student commons. Hey, I'm guessing you're Roscoe.
Yes, I am.
Roscoe, welcome. My only guess is because of the height.
Yeah.
Nice to have you.
Thanks.
Okay, we're just getting started. I'm talking about logistics and stuff like that. Glad you could join us today. Actually, Amir, let's introduce ourselves, just so Roscoe knows who else is in the class too. So, please, introduce yourself to Roscoe.
I'm Amir, first year master's STC program here.
Miss Bianca, who are you?
My name is Bianca. I'm a junior in environmental systems engineering.
Great. And Roscoe, who are you?
I'm a senior in STS.
Fantastic. Thank you for joining us. Okay, just so you know all together, how many are there? I think there's eight of us all together in terms of like trying to like work with us. So some people may be joining in a little bit later. We were just getting started with some of the very basic logistical stuff in terms of, you know, we'll continue to have these live sessions every week. I'm kind of a drop in as you can and drop out when you need to, sort of basis. It's really just sort of based on whatever questions you have and trying to get that stuff answered. Just some things, office hours, every Tuesday and Thursday, we're just sort of in this room camped out in the late afternoon, which works for some schedules and not. There's three of us, or four of us all together on the teaching team, so there's actually three TAs who are available to help too. And I was saying that we're gonna set up a Piazza channel so that if you have questions, you just wanna throw them over the wall into the mix, just anyone can go through and like help answer those questions. So. And then in terms of the assignments, the way we were starting to lay it out is that there's six assignments all together. The field research station is just all about getting started. We'll sort of work on that a little bit together today. Two and three are really related to a vacation house up in Tahoe where you design it in one assignment and then you render it in the other one. Four and five actually work together. That's all about doing a kind of education building. So I call it an engineering student commons. It's almost as though if you could imagine that the Wong Center wasn't there and you were trying to create a building that had, meeting spaces for students, classrooms and like project rooms that people could work on, a cafe so people could hang out and kind of meet and, you know, just a lot of buildings or spaces that are all about just how students work together when they're outside of the classroom. That's what that building's all about. And in four, you design the building. In five, you actually start putting a structure inside of the building. Okay, so all the beams and columns and kind of all the individual elements that kind of support the structure. Finally, six, just so you know what's going on there, that's really all about parametric design. And what you're going to find out is as you're working with Revit and we're kind of doing all these different assignments, you go to the library and you pull down all these parts. You pull down windows, or you pull in pieces of furniture like desks and chairs and stuff like that. You start creating your own pieces like that. So you learn how to change existing ones to be what you want and also kind of create your own. So it's really just sort of the extension of a lot of what we're doing that gives you independence. So you can really kind of just create your own parts and share them. Yeah.
Is a large element of this class learning like the way that product or not products but building elements come together and like the physics of that, or is that sort of, is it sort of mostly just learning the software and the software kind of does the hard part of like the science? And
it kind of merges together in some way. It's a very good question. It's a really good one to ask about. I think actually this class is really all about like basic building construction. Okay, so we learn a lot of that because you have to sort of really understand that and model that using the software.
So apart from the software, learning building construction.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you'll learn a lot about that as you go. And I think you'll find that for a lot of what we're going to do, it's fairly straightforward. We start out with sort of simple wood frame construction, which for a lot of folks is familiar because it's like, if you've ever built a house or seen a house being built, kind of a very common technique. You know, here, it's different in different parts of the world. As we get to the Engineering Student Center, there we'll shift to more of a structure which is more like a commercial structure. So it could have a steel frame and just have cladding on it, something more like a commercial building is done today. But yeah, overall, I think you're right. It's this really interesting mix where we want you to learn the tools and we want you to learn the process of how people are using these tools, but you sort of learn it by designing things. Mm-hmm. So it's a little bit of all three, which is hopefully going to be a fun mix. I think a lot of people do have fun in the class because compared to a lot of other things, this is one where the assignments don't have like set answers. It's not like doing a problem set where you grind it through and you get a fixed answer and then you're done. This is actually, it's as creative as you want it to be. And it'll be funny to see where you all come from because some people are very creative architecturally. Some people aren't. They think more about how things are built and how the engineering works and put it all together, and that's all okay. And you'll sort of learn from each other that like, oh, okay, like she is really creative and knocks it out, but I don't think that'd be very easy to build. Mm-hmm. And you can sort of share that. Mm-hmm. It's really sort of an interesting just mix. And I think we learn as much from each other as about the tool. So yeah, the tool's there in the background, but it's definitely, it's a supporting role. Okay, it's not the star attraction. Like the design work you do is the star attraction. Okay, so, a good question. People always ask that. It's a really weird class in that it's positioned in a funny way. Ultimately, what we hope you do is you develop some really good job skills that, you know a lot about this technology, which is really changing the way we're doing AEC. You know, really, so much of it is really based on these building models and how we use them to share the information. And that's really transforming the relationship between owners and designers and contractors. And we all work through these models. So, at a high level, you should be sort of understanding that and being prepared to, when you get out of here, really kind of be able to lead in the industry as they make this transition. Because, transitions aren't always an easy thing. So, it's really helpful to know a lot about what's going on there. Okay, last thing logistically, interactive check-ins. Just so you know, in terms of how the assignments are going to work and stuff like that, you'll go ahead and when you're ready to turn something in, just basically send us a message and we'll send it to the Piazza channel saying, hey, I'm ready for a check-in. And what'll happen then at that starting point, you'll meet with one of us, whether it's Afalabi, Gustavo, Nikos, or myself, just kind of whoever sort of fits when you have some time available. What we do is we sit down with you and just like walk through the assignment and kind of look at it and say, oh, okay, great. This is super, that's looking really great. Oh, you might want to look at this over here and kind of give you some suggestions about, different things that could be sort of improved to kind of make the drawing more communicative, clear about what your design intent is and all that type of stuff. But really, we do it all as a series of just interactive check-ins. So think of this as very much being a mentored, guided process. It's not like you'll turn it in and, you'll get, great, that's an A. It's just sort of more a series of mentored, coached check-ins, stuff like that. Okay, so I don't know. Everyone sort of survives and generally does pretty well. The only way to not do all those classes is just not to do the assignments. Okay, so but if you get them all done, you're going to do okay. It just sort of works. Okay, so feel free. Use that as an empowering force to kind of say that, okay, I can try weird and interesting things. I'm not going to get dinged for it. Okay, so, but don't abuse it because, it's like I give you a lot of rope. Just don't hang yourself with it. It's one of those things. Okay, so use that. Okay. Questions about logistics? Nope. You generally good? My allergies are dying too. So
yeah,
it's like
it's been rough.
I'd give you a leg rip. I had one. It's like or something. Okay. Super. If not, let's go ahead. And what I would love to do more than any day is kind of look at sort of assignment one, looking at it through one of your models in terms of kind of saying, okay, given that, how would we start to really move from just sort of the basic building design? We'll look at that, any questions you might be having about that. But then start thinking about, oh, how you add annotations and kind of set up the views and crop them and add style to them and teach you a lot of tricks about how you get them ready to put on sheets and share them. Okay? So to do this, I would dearly love to have someone's model to play with. Oh, I have a volunteer. Okay, excellent. A brave volunteer. If you can go ahead and give me your model. It's always more interesting with your model. Oh, great. You're looking good, too. That's fantastic. Okay. So this is the vacation house.
Yes.
You're already marching ahead. Okay, good. Excellent. Okay, super. Then...
Are you okay to film the first one?
Oh, no worries. Either way. For the first one, we're going to, like, I'm just going to play around. I'm going to start with just putting the views on the sheets and all that kind of stuff. Actually, what's your time frame today in terms of how long can you stay?
Until one.
Until one? Okay, good. Let's focus on assignment one for the first hour, and then we'll look at assignment two. Okay, and then we'll do the vacation house. Excellent. Okay. Super. So I'm going to work with Bruno's assignment one. And if you're on assignment two, has anyone else started assignment two yet? Not yet? Okay, then. You have? Excellent. Okay. We may look at Roscoe's or yours. We'll look at them both in terms of trying to think about these vacation houses and what they can look like. And again, if you cut on out, was that?
Can I ask a question about assignment two?
You certainly can.
Something about like underground.
Yes.
Like there's a slope.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
You just put a pad.
You just put a what?
A pad.
Yeah.
And then it like digs into the ground for you.
We'll demonstrate that now. You're gonna leave at noon, right?
Yeah.
We'll show you that. Okay, in terms of what's going on. Okay, so let's start out with, we will just open your model. Okay, where did it go? It's kind of around here somewhere. I want it to be out here. I don't see it out there. What's going on? Win install. It's on Win install. There you are. Let me think about why that's not showing up right now. It's there. As many of you will figure out, I got this strange Mac PC arrangement going on here. Actually, it's funny, you have a Mac. Do you have a Mac too?
I have a Mac, but I put parallels on it.
Oh, no worries. It's like, and we're trying to come up with a computer for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's like, we all have Macs.
I'm sure there's a really easy way to do this, but I don't know how to align sync with the counter, because there's like a hole for the sync.
We will look at this. Okay.
I'm sure there's like an align tool. It's really easy, but...
you're going to find some that these are all good questions. Let's really look at just lots of little tricks and techniques to help you go. So we'll start just by looking at your model, okay? And then kind of go from there. Okay, so here we have your model. Let's go ahead and take a look at the floor plan just to get ourselves started. I'm going to just expand that out a little bit. Okay, so talk us through. What do we got going on here? I can sort of see some different things, but walk me through the plan.
So the entrance is right there, yeah.
Okay.
And the first room, just a lobby, and it has the 8-foot long bench.
Okay, over here on the side.
And the small sink.
Mm-hmm.
It's not lined up yet.
No worries.
And then there's the bathroom to the left.
Okay.
And then the small meeting room is to the right, yeah, there. And then if you are... There's a big door, like a double door,
mm-hmm.
into like the office space. And
mm-hmm.
I decided to put all three like office spaces together, kind of in one big room.
Great.
So they can work together and talk to each other. And then the storage room is to the right.
Good. What's this guy here? It's like a piece of
table.
Table. Very good.
I thought I needed something so I could put like brochures.
Oh, no worries. Sounds very good. Thank you for sharing it. Okay, let's go ahead and answer some specific questions about thinking about the whole thing. Working with a small space, when you're working with a small space, one of the hardest things is really trying to figure out how to squeeze everything in. And it's really tricky with only 500 square feet. We'll take a look at that for just a second. Overall, your modeling looks looking pretty good here. There's some different things about sinks and countertops. We're going to help you with that for just a second. As you look at the walls, I'm seeing some things I'm liking in that you have some walls that have some real thickness to them. So these walls are what? These are some sort of siding walls. Super, that's looking good. Okay, as I go zipping around, kind of looking at the other walls. Very good, they're looking all fine. It's interesting. I'm seeing on my screen, there's this funny thing where that wall looks so skinny, but it isn't. I think that's a really weird kind of just graphical thing going on because it's swinging around and it is okay.
Is that because it's an exterior wall that you see the thickness?
This should all be thick. It's kind of interesting. Oh, I think it's just really, what's happening, it's just a trick in the way I'm perceiving it. They're actually, the thickness is in there. It's just because of the angle right there. They look very thin right there. No, they're all thick. That should be good. In terms of what you've done, let's go to the floor plan for a second and look at, yeah, here. You can sort of see we have all these walls. And in these layers, you can sort of see the exterior layer where the siding is. We can see the interior core. You can see the chipboard on the inside. That's all looking good. Okay. Just as you're working, just for everyone, if you are not seeing all those layers, that's all controlled down here. There's this little widget down here at the bottom that controls. It's called the coarseness of the view or the fineness of the view, anywhere from coarse to fine. Coarse, if you're looking at that, just shows kind of the overall thickness, but doesn't show the layering. If you change it to medium or fine, it'll actually show the layering, which is good. Because,
how do you get that coarse?
Okay, it's way down here at the bottom where it says, so it's right next to the scale, 1/4 inches of the foot. There's a little pull down, pull up over there. And if you choose medium or fine, it'll show the layers versus not. And that'll be helpful because for some things like, oh, as you look at, for example, this corner over here, you have that little issue there, really, how they're going to frame that corner. Now, this is always sort of an interesting one. Framers will give you all sorts of different answers. You have these 2x6 walls on the outside, which is good because there's lots of room for insulation. On these inside walls, it's 2x4. They're a little bit smaller, okay, because you don't need the extra wood there for the insulation. But if you line them up, and this is going to start to get to the whole issue of aligning things, there's all sorts of different tricks. For example, when we come here, we have that funny little corner out there. So what will happen sometimes when framers line up a thick outside wall with an interior wall is they'll actually align it to the other side. So what they'll do is they'll try to get this line over here in line with that line so that the chipboard is even on across all the inside. Yeah. To do that, there's a lot of funny ways. These look like they're currently aligned by the center lines of the walls. We can use, this is where the align tool is. The align tool is if you choose any of the walls, for example, we'll say modify walls, because you have a wall chosen, so the modify tool changes. Actually, watch out for that as you work. As you choose different things, this modify tab will always change to tell you what you've selected. So if you don't have a wall selected, it just says modify. Now it's modifying the floor. If I choose a wall, it'll say modify the floor walls. Okay. But one of the tools that's really handy is align, because align is allowing you to do this. Align works by this with this method. What you're going to do is basically choose the align tool, and you'll choose the thing that you want to align to, and then you'll choose the thing that you want to align to it. So it's basically choose a point, then pull you to me. Okay, it's, you know, it's, so the order of operations is, I, for example, will try to get that line. Now notice at starting, it's going to just sort of highlight the center line. What I can do is tab, though, and that'll be the outside face. I could align it outside face, or I could align the core to the core. There, to here. And let's see if it'll shift it on over there. Working. So that would actually be sort of a common way to do it. In the same way over here on this one, I might go ahead and take that wall and align the studs on this side to it. And it just makes for a neater corner. Of course, it means the other corner might be messed up, but we'll take a look at that. It sort of depends where you really need the corner. Back over here, yeah, looks like we're pretty good over there. You'll notice that overall the walls are doing a pretty good job of healing themselves up. So that's actually looking good in terms of the chipboards merging to the chipboard layer, the stud layers merging. It's just doing that based on the materials. Okay, and it seems like it's doing a pretty good job there. Let me show you another view that may or may not be true on yours. It's just another little viewing widget. It's this guy up here. This is the whole idea of if the lines are going to be displayed in very thin lines, or if I turn that off as thick lines. Let's talk about the difference. Thin lines is make them kind of wafer thin so you can really see all the detail. The opposite, thick lines, is really it's going to show them the way it would look when it's plotted. Okay, so when you actually print it, it'll show up as thick, heavy lines like that around the outside versus the thin lines. And often we like that thick, heavy line because then you can really see where the walls are. So that's just sort of a little distinction as you're working. Often as you're working, it's better to turn on the thin lines just so that you can really see kind of where the edges are and kind of get those things to align easily. Okay, no worries. Let's take a look at a few other things here as you've placed all your things in here. Okay, talk about those. Windows actually have an inside and an outside side, just doors and windows. Doors are actually pretty good. You got the idea of how to put those in there. So you can put them in there and you can flip them around if you need to. That's okay. Windows actually have an inside and an outside too. And let me show you how that works. This is a casement window. Okay. The inside, or when you're placing a window, let's start with that. I'll put another one right in here. If you hover just to the side, you always want to hover to the exterior side. It'll put the window in there, and then the little flippy arrows showing where the hinge is and which side is the inside or the outside is always showing on the outside. So on your windows, just small little thing is like that. We could actually flip inside out. And really what that's putting, it's just putting the window and the part that swings to the outside as opposed to the inside. So it has a deep frame on the inside and the window's on the outside edge and flipping out. And just to sort of see what that looks like over here, for casement windows, it doesn't make a very big difference. You can sort of see them here. You can sort of see the glass is towards the outer frame. But if you look closely, you can even spot at the bottom of the windows. It looks a little bit different. The inside has frame all around. The bottom, the outside just has this little sill at the bottom. The idea here is if the rain hits the window, it's going to sheen on down, and there's really not a whole lot of exposed wood there to kind of catch the water and kind of have a problem. So if any window is flipped inside out, no worries. You can just either do it in the floor plan, or you can even right-click it here and say flip facing, and that'll rotate it around. Okay, it's the same as those little things. Now, the casement windows, they're pretty easy because we'll just do that. If you actually put in a double hung window, let's see if you have anything like that. Looks like most of your windows are casement. Okay, no worries. If you put in a double hung window, that's really easy to spot. Let me kind of show you what one of those looks like. Double hung window is like one of these ones that you typically see in houses. I'll put it in the wall over here. That one actually is the right direction. I can spot it because it has just a window sill. It doesn't have the frame trim at the bottom. And also, in terms of the inner pane, it'll slide up inside as opposed to the outer pane, which is staying out there. So just watch out for that. As you're putting in windows, I've been putting these in 3D. It's always a little bit hard in 3D to do that because you're never quite sure if you got the right height. But if you have the windows, let's see what height your windows are.
Can you align them to the same height?
You certainly can. Okay, you're at 7 feet right now, which is a very common dimension. A lot of commercial buildings have everything lined up at 7 feet. A lot of houses have them at 6'8", so just a few inches, 4 inches lower. But we tend to use a consistent measure across, so you'll have everything at 70, your doors will be at 7 feet. Your doors will be at 7 feet or 84 inches tall. Everything will be at 7 feet, or it'll be 6'8". Okay, like in this building, everything's at 7 feet. If you look at all the doors, it's at 7 feet, and then this little rail follows around at 7 feet, and then it even comes to here at 7 feet. We do this thing with our eye where we line everything up at the same distance. Okay, so these are at 7 feet. Now, as you're putting them in here, you may not quite get them, especially if you do them in 3D. And the easiest way to fix that is two ways. I can either come on in here and just change the number as one of the properties, or Another way, you sort of said the magic word, you said a line, which is really good. If you look at the elevations, okay, you can go through and use the align tool. So that same align, let me go ahead and just go to modify, you'll find it. So I can say really the upper edge of the window, I'll just do it on that edge right there. And that one right there. I'm gonna align to each other. Or that one, we're gonna align them to each other. We can even lock them together. Locking is kind of an interesting thing. If you lock things, that means that if one moves, the other one will move with it. So for example, if I take that window and I shove it down, they'll go together. So think about locking as being an interesting thing to do every once in a while. What locking is really good for is it sets up what's called a parametric relationship between things, and that window height is not just an arbitrary number, it's related to another number. And that's a really good thing in that, like, as things change, the overall size and shape of things can change. For example, with it, this house, currently, the roof is at 8 feet, 8 feet tall walls, that's kind of good. As you put in the walls, you probably put them in there from first floor up to level roof, and that's a good relationship to have, because if you do have that relationship, oops, I see what you did. You are what's called unconnected, and you're attached. Okay, and let me kind of show you what that is. I'm going to detach it just so everyone can see how that works. Okay, by default, Revit puts in these walls that are 20 feet tall, which look incredibly tall, and you're wondering why you'd want that. When you put in the roof, though, it'll say, would you like to attach them? And you can, and then it'll chop them off. Okay, and then they're attached to the bottom of the roof. Now, that's kind of generally sort of okay. This roof over here is currently sitting at the roof level. But how this all works that's kind of interesting is if you say that the roof level, for example, is going to change, so it's going to go from 8 feet to 10 feet, pop it on up, then the walls stretch with it. Okay, and that's kind of a good relationship to have because then parametrically, no matter what happens, if somewhere during the construction someone tells you, oop, we can't afford 10-foot walls, we need to bring them down, you just have to change it one place. Everything will change with it. Okay, let's just go back over here. For the most part, your model is looking really good. Just little random comments about the model, some things to check there. We actually asked for this whole little thing in there about, you know, just in terms of your bathroom, for example, allowing the 5-foot circle. And I think you've definitely accommodated that. I think you look really good there. Sometimes if you want to show that you have a 5-foot circle in there and all that, you can actually put an annotation in there. We'll talk about all of that annotations. Annotations are dimensions, they're lines that indicate things, just anything that sort of exists in addition to the model. We could go ahead and put an annotation. A detail line is a line that'll show up only on this sheet. So just a drafting line that sort of has some information. So we could say, and there's different styles, we can create some different styles. I'll just kind of put like a kind of a hidden line, kind of a dashed line in there. But I'll just draw a circle in here. That has the 5-foot radius, or it's a 5-foot diameter. Super. And then we can go through and have that to indicate that's the turning radius in case a wheelchair needs to sort of show that it has all the room that it needs. Now, when you're drawing things, we're going to talk about dimensions in a minute, but as you're drawing things, if you ever see this is a temporary dimension, and you see this little glyph right here, which looks like a dimension line, what that'll do is it'll turn a temporary dimension into a permanent dimension. So if you actually like to go through and keep that dimension, okay, you can click on that, and that'll actually make it a dimension that stays. So let me take that out and show it the other way. Again, if you draw it, okay, you'll get that little temporary dimension. Okay. Typically, though, it goes away. If you come on back, you might be able to get it back. There it is. And if you click it, you'll get the dimension. Okay. And that's just sort of a good thing to put in there if you're going to go through and put that circle in there. so that you can see that. That's going to be associated with a circle. So I can move that circle around if I want to. Say again?
Do you just click diameter and then draw?
You can do that too. Actually, for me, in terms of the drawing, what did I do? I did the radius and did that. So ask your question again. Yeah, I guess I'm not sure. If I have the circle, I could, if you say, oh, diameter over here, that's gonna do a diameter dimension. So if I have the circle already, I can say, choose the diameter dimension and then choose that and then it'll dimension it that way. So that diameter hanging around there, that's actually, it's not for drawing, it's not a drawing tool, it's more a dimensioning tool. Whereas under the, if you choose the detail line drawing, you sort of get these tools over there. Okay. In terms of the specific question you asked, you said, hey, I've got a sink and I've got like a little kind of countertop over there and I'd like to get them together. So let's talk about that. This countertop is one of those pieces that you load in from the outside world. You load it in from the library and you kinda can put it down there and there it is. And you know, as you have it there, you can move it around if you want to. I can move it over to the corner. That's all good. You could also, notice it has those little blue arrows on it. This countertop is actually set up with these little stretchy arrows. So if it turns out the countertop is not the dimension you want, and you wanna make it longer, you can just go ahead and drag it on out there. So that part's pretty good. There's the sinkhole. You might wonder how to align the sinkhole and the sink, and usually you can just go ahead and drag that over and line it up, and that'll sort of work. Although that looks like it was about to stretch in a very strange way. It looks like as I stretched that out, it also stretched the end too, which is kind of a funny hierarchy, but that'll sort of work. Okay, so now I got a very big sinkhole, but that's not exactly what I want. For this sink, let's take a look at that. This is a wall sink, a rectangular wall sink. This is one that's kind of like, oh, it's almost like the ones inside of the single restrooms here where it's, well, you can sort of see the picture of it there. It's a porcelain, it's mounted out of the wall. You can kind of wheel up under it or something like that. If we want to have more of a countertop sink, let's kind of see if we can find something like that. Let's see what I got out here. I got a component. What do I have? Sink vanity, sink wall oval, there's a sink kitchen seat, sink lab. You might use one of these sinks instead. This is more of a sink that, it's just kind of one that's gonna fit into a countertop. So you can put something like that in there. Okay, and then after you've put it in there, the idea is to go through and just align that to it. That one out. That's actually a really good sink for your restroom. If you want to put that one in there. So you have a like a pedestal sink right now. Super. So you could have a wall sink or a pedestal sink over there. Okay. And even in terms of your 3D model, you have, okay, it's currently just this nice kind of sink over there. If you want to start thinking ahead to cabinets, and you will for assignment two, you didn't necessarily have to do it for here, but if you want to start thinking ahead to cabinets, there's all sorts of cabinetry available to you too. Let's see if I have any in the project. I don't think I put much in there. Usually they're sort of in the list, kind of close to the top. I do have some base cabinets. I have a two-door cabinet or a single-door cabinet. So for example, if you want to put some cabinetry in there, underneath, you can go through and put some of that in. So I'll put a 36-inch cabinet there. Maybe a cabinet next to it. A good thing to do, if you are putting cabinets in, is to use that align tool. The align tool works really well for you. So you can say, hey, let's go ahead and I'll, for example, I'll put this right under the sink. Okay, that's looking pretty good. Or even better, if you want to align things, you can align, and you can align from the middle of the sink the middle of the cabinet and lock those together. That way the cabinet and the sink are always going to stay together. Then maybe the edge of this cabinet's going to have that one locked to it. And then you start creating, it's almost a hierarchy of the order of dependencies between all the different objects. so that you can actually keep everything together. That way, if the sink moves, like the cabinets are going to move, but I can sort of place things around it. Okay, now it looks like my cabinets are a little low relative to my sink, so let's figure out what's going on there. My cabinets are probably 36 inches tall. This is, the width is there. Ah, you have a little offset on it. The way the sink is designed is by default, it sort of defaults to 36 inches above the floor. Putting the 2-inch offset just raised it a little higher still. So if I put that back down to zero, I think it'll go back down. Okay, now it's gonna sit closer to the top of the cabinets. Okay.
Wait, sorry, that difference was in the counter and the sink, or the cabinet and
it's,
the counter?
It was the difference between the countertop and the cabinets. The way it works right now is, this is currently set up, it looks like it's at 36 inches, and then what happens is, this is basically coming up to the bottom of that, although it looks like it's not even quite joining just yet. So we can take a look at that. But it's the offset in terms of raising it higher or lower than. Every part sort of has a natural height, and then you can kind of raise or lower it a little bit based on what you need. Okay, so overall, your design is looking really good here in terms of what's going on. Some things to think about, this is my screen. As a designer, as I'm looking at this, okay, I like you have your little separate conference room, that's kind of cool over there. You might think about for this whole space, whether you need to really separate these two different rooms. Yeah, so if I was really trying to conserve space or make the space feel as large as possible, I might, for example, this is just my suggestion, there's nothing right or wrong about it, take out this part of the wall and sort of let that just be like a big workspace in general, and just have the conference room over there be separate. So if I did something like that, and again, there's just a zillion and one theories about how to do this, you could, and this is, I just want to demonstrate how quick it is to sort of play around with these games. Oh, I'm going to go to Modify. I'm going to use the trim tool. The trim is one of my favorites. You can go ahead and use it to kind of cut corners. So if I say I want to use this wall and that wall there and trim them together, okay, it's going to do just fine. It's going to tell me I can't put that door in there. So that might just make a big open room. You could then kind of pull this back. And finally, over on this door, I might go ahead and make that a double door, just because I like the idea of kind of being able to get into that. So maybe I even double the glass door, so it has a little kind of glass at the front. I'll make it 7 feet tall so it matches the other ones. It's a little off right now. Shove it over there. So that's a nice big conference room, or whatever, it feels big. Okay, so super. So I think your design is looking fantastic. So you're good on that front. As we look at this, let's look at it. The walls, all that kind of stuff, the windows, that's all looking fine. If we look at it from the standpoint, I'll look at it in the either 3D view or one of the elevation views. You got your roof on here. So you have a roof which is kind of, it's what I'll call the most standard type of roof. Actually, let's talk about this whole issue of the roof. So we're looking at it right now. I can see my roof over here. I can see my roof from my 3D view. So tell me how you got rid of the roof.
I went to, in 3D view, and I went to the roof and did visibility.
Okay.
And then edit, and then I checked.
Great. Okay, a very sensible way to do it. So you say visibility graphics. We went on down there and found the roof, and turned it off. Super. Now, if you want to sort of have it and not have it at different times, here's my general rule of thumb. If you find yourself going to visibility graphics and turning things on and off more than about 3 times, you're a candidate for just creating another view. So what you can do is take this 3D view and duplicate it with or without the detailing. There's no lines to sort of copy here, so it won't matter. But I'll say this is 3D view. And you can kind of rename it. I'll say, okay, great. That's the 3D view. And I'll say, let me keep the brackets without the roof. Okay, so I could have with the roof and without the roof, and I can keep as many as I want. Because you probably found that as you were working, it was helpful to hide the roof so you can see inside. Okay, So let's go ahead and go without the roof and show you that, so we can hide it that way. Yes, Roscoe.
Can you show after this one the section one? Can you like drag it up and down?
Sure. That's actually even a better way to do it. Okay, so this is just hidden roof. Okay. Actually, I'll say that. We'll make that just hidden roof. But as Roscoe points out, there's even a better way to do this. Okay, go back to the 3D that has the roof. Here we are. There's this fantastic thing called the section box, and the section box does this. It's really one of my favorite tools in Revit. What it does is, get that away, you can go through and for 3D view, turn it on. It is right there. So what you have to do is just be in a 3D view and you turn on section box, and it creates this thing that looks like a big shoebox around the building. Okay, this shoebox has this property. You can go ahead and push and pull the handles and kind of either trim it on the top. I can trim it on the sides. So this is really nice because you can create these nice interactive 3D section views. So that's actually pretty good. Okay. So I like this view. I like this view so much, I'm going to go ahead and save this one away. Duplicate the view. Call it, rename it as 3D section box. Okay, that's another really good way to do it. Now, the whole section box thing is such a cool technique for working that there's actually some shortcuts that are really useful for you in terms of working with it. So you can really take any 3D view and kind of turn on the section box to a specific location. Let me show you what I mean that might actually be useful to you. Oh, I'm gonna go to your first floor plan for a second. And one view that I might like to see is just a nice section cut through the building. So I'm gonna just take this view and cut a section through here. And that's going to create a nice little section, just a kind of flat one. That's kind of looking good. But you might say, hey, I like that view, but I'd really like it to be in 3D. So here's how it works. If you come to the 3D view, and you, this is going to sound really weird, you take the view cube and you right click on it, you can say orient to a view and then choose a view, like the section. And what'll happen is it'll take the section box and change it so its perspective matches the 2D view. So here it is. I'm going to choose that section I just cut. Okay, it's going to flatten it out. That's not looking very good. But it's actually just the 3D cut that matches that 2D view. So it's real easy to get 3D sections. Okay, and in a 3D section, the nice thing is like this. You say, hey, okay, that wall, boy, I didn't notice it didn't go up to the roof. Maybe I should attach that to the roof. Okay, are these walls over here in the same sense if you want to attach those to the roof? So 3D sections and stuff like that are really useful.
Could you repeat how to get that?
Sure. What you do is you just, first you create a section. Any section, or okay, do you have a section to work with?
Yeah, the 3D one or the other?
Just any old section. Do you have a plan? Okay. What you do is just in your 3D view, right click, and you say orient to view, and then you choose the section in that list. So it's just a, so you go to the view cube. That's the hard part. There's this hidden menu there that you really never see, and you wonder, where is it? And that's where it's hiding under there. And you can go through and then orient it to a section. Another thing that's really cool, though, just in terms of these section views, is you could go through and orient it to a floor plan. So if I orient it to the first floor plan, for example, and then orbit that, that's a real easy way to get one of those 3D floor plans. So if you like the idea of a 3D floor plan, it's just, it's a little bit quicker or easier than just turning on and off the visibility graphics to do it this way. So great. You can create these views as necessary. Now for these views, let's take a look at these for a second. You know, you have them turned on the way I actually kind of like to see it. I like to see them shaded this way. It sort of helps my eye to see the color and kind of sort it all out. There's some other views that are available, just so we can kind of go through all the little kind of glyphs down here. We can go through and Get that out of the way. A hidden line is black and white. Shaded shows us the colors. Let me show you the difference between shaded and consistent colors. A slight difference there. Consistent color is like shaded, but it doesn't take into account the lighting, where shaded does. And you can even turn on something called realistic, which may not make look very good just yet, but as we start putting real materials on things, it's more like a rendered view. Okay, so there's a lot of different view choices there. I'll just go with shaded for now. Okay. Another thing you can do, and some people like to do this, is if they like to see shadow, because shadow is actually a very useful way of kind of looking at things, you can turn on the shadows or turn them off. Okay. But we got some basic views here. Okay, and I think we're in pretty good shape. So let's talk about the things we typically add to the views to go through and get them ready to submit and how we crop them. And then we'll finish up with this one. So typically on these sorts of views, you already have some nice looking dimensions on here. That's looking good. Let me talk about dimensions and how we usually do them to kind of make it very complete. You have over on this side a really nice dimension, a nice overall dimension. Go ahead from start to finish. That's looking good. A very common way of doing this is we'll say we do an overall dimension in each direction. So that's a really good way of overall people figuring out how big the building is. I'll go to annotate, I'll say a dimension, and let me give you just a little nuance on dimensions. For dimensions, you'll see, actually, tell me where you see right now. Where is your dimension going to?
Center line of the
wall. Beautiful. Okay. What we often will do is, it's going to sound really weird, we pick what's called the core face, which is the face of the studs. Because the face of the studs is when someone's actually laying out the building, they'll measure to the face of that and then put the finishes on the inside or the outside. So if we want to dimension to those, I'll just shift over for my preference to say faces of the core. Okay. And now as I'm clicking on this wall, let me go ahead and, that's the one I actually want. It's a little hard to see in this one just because I'm sort of at a scale. It makes it hard to see. I want to get that face. Okay. And now I'm going to zoom out. I don't have my mouse with me today, which makes it a little bit hard to work. And I'll see if I can zoom in on this side. And I'll get to that face right there. Okay. And then after I've placed sort of the two kind of reference lines, or witness lines, they call them. I'll put it out there. Okay. So that's a nice overall dimension. So usually what happens in terms of dimensions is we'll do this. We'll go through and we'll do the overall. Then we'll have one. The second one that I'll usually put is really going to any corners or any interior walls. So for example, this is a really good one here, and then the dimension here to here is actually pretty good because that's sort of indicating the outside edges. So what you can do there is, for this existing dimension line, what I'll do is just choose it, and I'll right-click on this. Actually, I can just click the button if I want to. That'll rotate through the options. But if that's not doing such a good job, I'll right-click on it, and I'll say Edit the Witness Lines, and bring it to the edge over here. See if I can get to that. There it is. Oops. And that wasn't quite right. That again. So I got too many of them in there. Let's get back over here. I'll get rid of this one. Delete that witness line. Move it over there. Okay. On the other side, kind of a similar sort of thing.
The screen went black.
Oh, let's do that. Okay, on this side over here, what I'm gonna do is move this one out to the outside wall. I'm gonna have to zoom in to sort of see where it's going. And then after that one's out, I'll go back and say, let's edit this. take it over to here. So you can play around with the dimension lines. Overall, we like them like that. Just in the end, so you finally know how we do something like this, you'll probably go through and actually go one step further. Oh, let me get that one back in. I didn't save it. It's a little off right there. Again. Edit. Zoom in. Come on over. Look out there. Okay. For the last dimension, what I usually do is something like this. We'll go through and just where these windows are coming in, because it's helpful to let the people who are framing it know just where the windows are going to be. We'll annotate this, and I'll say just really from this edge over here, and I'll go just to the center of the window, the center of the window, and the center of the window, and over here, right there. So now you're nice to the dimension. Now anyone can figure out how to go through and frame this. So often you'll have three dimensions. It's really the outer, you'll have to either corners or even this interior wall. Okay, and then you'll do windows there. So in the same sense on this wall, you have the outer there. That's looking pretty good right now. For the inner one, what I might do is I would go from here to this wall. Then down over there. And I'm tabbing to get those things. Okay, so dimensions are always a good thing to add. The other thing that's really good to add to your drawing is a little tagging. Let's talk what tagging is all about. Tagging is really just relating things that are here on the plan to things that are in the schedule. For example, you have all these great windows out here. These windows all have information. If I'd like to be able to see what the windows are in the floor plan view, what I can say is annotate, and as opposed to a dimension, and as opposed to text, text is always good, but text is just sort of static. I can put text out here, but it's just a string of text that's not really conveying any value besides what you type in there. There's this thing called tagging, and tagging is very useful. What tagging does is it displays some information about that object that you'd like to see, and usually we use it to sort of get things to sort of correspond between two different views. So for example, if I want to tag this door, for example, I'm going to turn off the leader so it's just sort of in the middle of the door. That is showing a door 3. So you might say, well, what good is that? What does that actually mean? If I go to the door schedule, you'll see I have door 1, 2, 3. It helps people make the connection between the floor plan and what's happening in the schedule. So over here, let's go for some of your other doors. I'll do a little tagging over here. I'll annotate and tag this door. It looks like door number 5. This is door number 2. This is door number 1. Okay, so now I have a relationship between those things. So I'm going to tag them and make them make sense. Okay, so usually I'll tag the doors and I'll tag the windows, because those are all things that people like to see. And then finally put this all together on a sheet. That'll be the last thing we do with this one. So I'll tag again, annotate. I'll tag this window. This is window 36, evidently. Window 36, window 38, window 36. You might notice that these 36s all sort of are indicating something in common. These are all windows of the same type. They all have the same size and shape. And whereas this window over here, 38, seems to be smaller. It's a little bit different. 36 here, 36, 36. So most of those are that type 36 window. Now, just so you know, if you have a lot of things to tag, you don't have to tag them all individually. You can say tag all. And then you can say what category of object you want to tag. So I'll tag just all the windows. And nope, so it happened. Should have gotten it. Annotate. Tag all. Windows. Apply. What's going on here? Oh, only selected. Excuse me. I have only selected objects. I want to say all objects. There we go. There we go. Now you have tags on them all.
So it'll appropriately tag like the smaller window will be distinct from the,
exactly,
the larger ones.
So here's my 36 window. What it's doing is, if you want to even sort of see where it's getting the number 36 is, it's a type property. It's a property of all the ones. It's not the instances. It's every individual one, all the types as a family have them. They have a mark called 36. Now, what I'll usually do is change this, because what is 36? 36 seems like an arbitrary number. I'll make those window A. So if I change them to A, all the A windows change to A.
And that'll update in the schedule.
Exactly. So you can do it either way. Here's the schedule. It's, oops, actually, let me talk about the schedule. Hey, where's everything in the schedule? Everything seems to be missing. This schedule's just sort of set up in a funny way right now. What we're going to do is, it has something called turned off. It has something called showing every instance turned off. And we just need to turn that back on. Under sorting, I can say itemize every instance. And there they are. What was happening is they were grouping them all, and all the windows are a little bit unique, so they're showing a little bit differently.
Could you repeat what you just did?
Sorry. Okay. It's under sorting and grouping. There's this thing called itemizing every instance. Okay. So by default, it was turned off, because often with Windows, you don't do that. I'm going to turn it back on. That'll show all of them.
Where is this?
Oh. What you got to do is, let's start with that. Under here, under on the browser, will be the door, room, and window schedule. So double click that. And there's probably nothing in the window schedule when you first open it up. What we'll do is go under, in the property palette now, there's a sorting or grouping. And you can say, itemize every instance. Now, let's do one other thing as long as we're over here. This thing actually has a bunch of tabs. Let's show a slightly different feel. Like, this is showing the mark. Mark is the individual ID. Type mark is the mark for the family. It's the ID of the family. So it's not even showing that. So if I want to see what all the A windows are, what I'm going to do is just show a different field. I'm going to go fields. I'm going to say, let's show the type mark. I can move that up. And now we'll see all the A windows versus the B windows. Now the good news is, you sort of ask the question of, does it really get everything kind of, or updated in both views? It does, in fact. You can even change it in both views. For example, I put that little double hung window in there. Actually, these are little transom windows. Those are the windows you put in the bathroom. If I want to make those B windows, just because I think it'll be easier to understand, I'll just change B here, and it'll change all of them. And now it's going to be my C window. So we'll get into schedules. Schedules are really, they're a whole separate animal about all the things you can do in terms of sorting and grouping and putting them together. But the idea is just to get the correspondence between those things. Okay, so Roscoe, are we able to kind of open it up and find it? Excellent. Okay, so we'll finish with this. Okay, you got some views, you got a nice floor plan view, we got some 3D views, we have all this fun stuff. I want to get it on sheets so we can share it with each other and communicate. You know, we tend to send pass models around, but you know, when we're sending them to other people who don't have the live models, they like it on big pieces of paper. So let's talk about how you do that. See if you have any sheets here. Okay, I set up some sheets to get going with. Let's kind of talk about what's going on. This sheet in the project browser is really like it's a big blank palette waiting for you to go ahead and put your model on there. So we're going to drag your view into here in just a second. How we do that is, with that sheet open, I just grab that first floor and drag it on in. And I put it over there. That's actually not looking too awfully bad. Now, as you put the views on, a couple things you have to worry about. Don't worry if there's a lot of white space all around your view, okay, because these things are 24 by 36, they're very big. And we tend to print things out at quarter scale. People understand quarter inch equals a foot. So don't worry about filling up like making a poster. It really is just put it on the sheet. You're good. Okay. Similarly, on the elevations, you can go ahead and drag those out. So take care. We'll put the east elevation. I'll go through and put the west elevation. Take care, Amir. No worries. Put them in there. They're looking pretty good. Notice as you put the elevations on there, north or south, let me put this in here, things will try to line up. put south on here too. As you move them up or down, if you get just to the right spot, like right there, you might see, you get this little inference line. What's telling me there is that basically those are lining up. They're kind of, and that's kind of nice when you get them all sort of lined up so you can sort of see around. In terms of these different views though, it looks like it might have a little trouble fitting on the sheet in terms of making it fit the boundaries. So we can take some of these views and crop them a little bit. That might be a good thing to do. So for any of these views, the coloration is just going to be whatever the shading is that's showing in the window. If you want to crop them, what you do is, if I want to go to like the south elevation and make it a little smaller, you see that box that's kind of hanging around it? That's the cropping box. And if you click on the box, you can sort of push in and pull out the boundaries. So let me make that a little narrower, just so it fits better. I'll bring that in over here. Okay, similarly on the north side, I'm just going to crop that a little bit closer just so it fits on the page a little bit better. So just like you do in Photoshop or something like that, just crop it on down. Okay, now go back to the elevation sheet. Now you will notice it's looking a little bit better. The boxes are smaller. That's kind of okay. So one thing that didn't change is, see the little title bars? They didn't shrink when you cropped. Okay, and the reason is their size is dictated when you first put it on the sheet. So if you want to update those, you must mess around with it individually and try to get it to be where you want it to be. But actually the easiest thing to do, it's going to sound like a really counterintuitive thing to do, is actually just backspace to take the drawing off the sheet and then drag it back on again. That sounds really weird. Like, why would you want to do that? But the net effect of doing that is when you bring them back in, it reassigns the title bars. Okay, so the title bars are always matching.
So you can only crop when you're in sheet view.
Actually, I'm going to show you that's not true. You ask very insightful questions. It's always what you want to do, and you can actually do what you want to do. Here's how you have to do it. So you can crop in the sheet view. That works. So I can definitely go back over here, you can crop in the view itself,
okay,
and you can move that box around. Okay, but if you're on the sheet view, which is often where you notice you need to do the cropping, you say, well, how do I do that? Okay, and here's how. These things are all really, they're called viewports. They're just portals to things in other places. So if you click on one and you want to actually do something inside of it, what you do is you double click it, or you can right click and say activated. They both do the same thing. But if you do that, notice everything turns gray except the thing that you activated. And when it's active, now you go ahead and change those things. Then you double click away and it deactivates it. So activating is like it's your secret wormhole that tunnels through and lets you do those things. And it actually works pretty well. For example, in this view, I'm looking at this. But I don't want that little double hung window there. What's that doing in there? Who put that in there? So you say, okay, I see it here, I want to change it. If you double click to activate it, the model's active now. So I can get rid of it. And that's about, it's gone everywhere. And that's the beauty again of all this kind of modeling stuff, is that as I change things one place, it changes anywhere. Same thing here. The roof of this is looking just a little bit tall. So let me go ahead and flatten that out a little bit. 912 is very steep. Maybe I'll make it 412, which is a little more modest. So I'll put 4 inches in there. Okay, and it adjusts it everywhere. So that's, again, you could do it in the sheet view, you could do it anywhere, but it kind of does it, read it. Okay. Last thing on these views in terms of putting on there, those 3D views are good ones to put out here. So if you really want to go through and drag those in there, they look good too. Oops. That one doesn't look like it's set to my section box right now. Again, if that's not right, I can activate it. Then I think this will work. Let's see if this actually works. I think it will. There we go. deactivate it. Okay, let's just pause there and like, yeah, see any questions, because like you got most of this done and you're sort of like checking back over your assignment and kind of taking a look at it. Like, are questions coming up, or like, you know, what else can we tell you about assignment one before I shift over to sort of the two-story version?
If you just want to look at it, that'd be perfect.
We'll okay.
Just to make sure I did it right.
Okay. Great. Come on over. Let's go and take a look at Roscoe's, and then
I'm gonna get some hot water. But
you go do that. And when you come on back, we will go ahead and take a look at the two-story version and how that works. Okay. So. Let's take a look. Okay. Looking good. Okay. So we've got it all nicely on the sheets and all that. Okay. Looking fine. So talk to me about it in terms of what's going on. As I'm looking at it,
do you just want to look at the floor plan? That's probably
sure.
The easiest.
And show me, can we have the big sweeping window, or it looks like it curves on the backside.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, let's do this, just so everyone can see. Can you put it on the thumb drive?
Sure.
That way, if I'm talking about yours, everyone will be able to see what it is, too.
All right.
That'll be better for everyone learning together.
I should connect with the windows, right?
Oh, either way. That's fine. You can put it on. Oh, do you have? Are you using parallels? Or using
virtual machines.
Okay, great. Good. Just go and throw it. See if you can't save it there. Pass it on up, and we'll take a look at yours. Actually, if you want to, go ahead and put your assignment two in there too.
Both of them.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. Why not? Gentlemen.
Hi, it's Greg. And my friend, he just searched for some house, and he's thinking of.
Okay, let's go ahead and get this plugged in. We'll take a look at Roscoe's. Okay, so.
It's weird being on this end. I'm also just watching.
It is strange, isn't it? I don't know. Okay, where did I put it? Let's get over here. What is Dalton like a shot? What did you bring us? Some nice tea?
Some tea?
No worries. I'm bad about that. Here's one. Okay, what we got here? Desktop. We're gonna look at Roscoe's. Not there. Get in desktop. I'm looking at the wrong one. Home. Desktop. I separated the two and it's creating a lot of confusion for me. Okay. Let's see what we got. You got Revit 2015 on your machine, okay, which is fine for what we're doing. Watch out if you ever work on your machine on the files on these machines that you're still working in 2015. If you ever open it in 2016 and then it'll change it, you won't be able to work on it in 2015 anymore.
Oh, okay.
Just watch out for that. You can keep on going in 2015.
Yeah, mostly just do it on here.
No worries. Don't get stung.
Yeah.
Okay, let us see. Okay, so talk us through, Roscoe, what you got?
So the front door is on the bottom left.
Okay.
Then you have the three desks on the upper wall.
Big open room,
desk on the far
art.
Left.
Yeah.
And the little meeting table area on the bottom.
Okay, on this side of the room.
I just put little stools that
you
sit on. And then the top right is the storage room, and the bottom left is the bathroom.
And overall, it's this nice, big, sweeping, kind of circular curved section. Super. This is, perfectly fine in terms of what's going on. Nice, simple plan, open, connected. I think you only have 500 square feet.
Yeah.
It's really not a very big room. We always think about it else in this room. This room is basically 38 by 20. Yeah, this room is bigger than this office. Yeah, the office you're talking about.
Oh wow,
it's 20. So this whole space is it's sort of 20 this way to 25 would be right about here. So
yeah,
it's not a huge space. It's always kind of weird because it sounds like a lot until you start putting it in there. Okay, furniture's looking good in there. That gives us a sense of scale and trying to understand how big things are. Let's look at the building overall as we're looking at it. Okay, so you got the dimensions. It looks like that's actually looking really good right now in terms of the overall, the intermediate ones, the tagging of the windows. You're right on target in terms of where you want to be there. That's looking good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, in terms of one other dimension type you can consider just to help with this whole thing, this is kind of always a really weird one, is there's a couple of dimensions you can consider. One's a radial dimension. Let me show you what that looks like. Radial is under annotate. You can say radial, and then you can choose that line, but it makes a very big arc because it's kind of off there in space somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
So this is kind of tricky about how to dimension this. This is really a hard one. Yeah, we could also go through and say for this, let me edit the witness line and see if I can catch a corner. Okay, that actually did catch a corner. Sometimes you can't on a circular surface like that. So what I'll do there sometimes, just so you know, so you have it in your bag of tricks, is
mm-hmm.
I'll go through and put a detail line in there. Just not much to it, but it's just enough to dimension to.
Okay.
Because sometimes when you're dimensioning, it doesn't like to dimension to non-parallel things. Okay, edit that. Let's see if I can catch that line. There we go. Something like that. Okay, that's another way to dimension that. A third way, and this is a really strange way of mentioning, but actually the guy Shahan and Han who were here were working on a house that actually has a lot of curved walls. Curved walls are hard to dimension. What do you do?
Yeah.
So one type of dimension that you use every once in a while, but not too often, is this one. It's called the arc length dimension. It's a little strange. How it works is you choose it, and then you choose the arc you want to dimension. And then you go clicking points on the arc. So go to the center of that one. Did I get that one? And then, hang on, I'm messing up. It's a weird one to use. Let's try it again. I'll say arc length. Let me go here to here. Okay, that's that. Let me go to this corner. And then finally I'll pick up this corner. I had to do this in a really weird way. I had to go between the two windows, which are easy, and then go out to the corners.
So window, window, and then the...
Then I did the outside corners.
It's giving me a big, like, stop sign type thing.
It's, let's see if we can get it to work on yours. It's, I know, it's a really weird one. Okay, so...
I clicked on the...
You got the arc?
The outer surface.
Okay, so just go for the window.
That's really hard.
Okay, and then I'll go there. Okay, now go to the outside corner. I think you got it. And then go to the other corner. Okay, now cool. Now I'll drop it. There you go.
So should I get rid of this line then?
Nah, actually, I think that line's actually a pretty good line.
Okay.
It's really, I just want to show you the arc length. Even though I'm not sure the arc length will be really good, it would help someone, for example, if they were going to measure the amount of siding, you'd say, oh, we need 26 feet one to that. It's curve things are just generally very hard to dimension. Okay, so your floor plan's looking great overall. I think you're in good shape there. We'll look at the elevations.
So
the
way that you were able to put storage, room, bathroom, how was it?
Ah, very good.
Was that with text or was that with
no, there's,
as well?
Tell us, Roscoe, then.
Annotation, I believe. There's room tags and space tags. Right?
So,
that's what I would use? Yeah.
And then you can insert your own name for them?
Yeah, and then once you like drop it in, it lets you edit it.
So I'm going to make another little
and
room
it, like,
out
calculates
here.
Calculates the square footage for you. So.
Okay.
Nice.
So there's another room, just kind of hanging out there. It's the back 40. We'll say, okay, let's take the room, which is an object, and make a room out of it. And when it's there, I put the tag into it. Today. Oh, that's not too bad. So that's a room tag. Now the room tag is actually kind of cool in that you can say with the area, we can say just the room tag alone, you can say with the volume if we compute the volume. But room tags are dynamic too, so even for them, if you drag on out, it changes. So it's better than just a piece of text because the text, yeah, it's kind of good. Oh, even this, I can say that's going to be the storage shed. And what happens with all these things is, even our storage bathroom, okay, is over here in the room schedule, they're all showing up over there. So the square footages are, so it's actually pretty good in terms of this room tagging, this whole tagging and scheduling thing is very useful. Okay, so you're looking great there. Okay, let's go take a look at your elevations. Your elevations are looking good here. The different sides. Ah, let's talk about this. You have this nice high window over here. I'll get rid of my storage shit. This is not going to do anyone any favors. Okay. You have this nice high window over here. You might notice on your floor plan it's not showing up. Hey, that's not good.
Yeah, I fixed it, but...
Ah, yeah. How did you fix it?
I just clicked on it and tagged it.
Oh, okay.
But, yeah, I gave you a slightly later
version. Oh, thanks, Yvonne. Things keep on working. Let's talk about how you can sort of do that. The problem is with a lot of rooms, for example, even in the bathroom, is there a window in there? There's
yeah,
these places
there,
where windows are high and they don't show. So let's talk about that.
And there's one on the north side of the storage room too that I forgot about.
So here's how it works. By default, okay, these views are cut at 4 feet above the ground. So if I say, okay, here we are, we're hanging around, let's just take a look at the view properties. It has this thing called the view range. It's cut at 4 feet, okay? So picture 4 feet. If you're intersecting, we show. If we're not intersecting, you don't show. So if you want to get something that's a little high, because the top bottom of the window is above that line, we do this. We come under view, and there's a special little thing called, it's under plan views. Oh, wait, hang on, where'd it go? Plan region, there it is. We'll choose plan region. What plan region does is it lets us draw a little area where in this case I know there's something like right about there. Actually it's probably bigger than that. or I'll say view range and give it a higher view range or a higher cut line. Then when I finish that up, it'll show kind of things at that higher elevation. So here, let's go ahead and make it bigger so it's sure to catch all that. There's that window. It's kind of interesting. I could even go through and make it sort of larger
and catch
that window too. It all depends on if the things of interest are going to get violated in that range. Turn that in the corner over here, it's not so bad because that's going to be consistent all the way up the wall. So it's not bad to cut that at 6 feet. And don't even worry about this little dashed box that's floating around because that just disappears. That doesn't show up on any of the printed views.
Where do you set it to 6 feet, sorry?
Okay, after you have the view range, over here in the properties, there's a edit right there, view range, and you can go through and change the cut plane to be something higher. I made it 6 feet just so that it would be sure to catch all that stuff. Okay, so this view range trick is really useful, especially if you have things like these clear stories, because there's all this stuff that doesn't show on a floor plan view, and you kind of get it in there. So that's a good trick there. Okay, so you do that, we'll tag those, you're gonna be in great shape. Okay, the other thing I wanna talk about, as I'm just looking at your design overall, is let's look at it in 3D. I'm gonna talk about your roof for just a bit. Okay, so let's think about your roof. Because I'm looking at that whole back sweep. This is architectural, this is not modeling, this is architectural. Over here, that's looking fine back there. You know, that big old rounded kind of edge, that's looking good. It's a little funky right here. So let's think about what we can do about that. There's a couple things we could do about that. We could go ahead, now actually, you should tell us what you did, because I think you did something sophisticated with your roof. It only slopes up for the one side.
I turned off the little angle, so they weren't determining the angle of the roof. I turned that off on all the back.
Okay,
walls.
So all the walls, like in Bruna's, they were on all sides, so you got it comes up from all sides. You turn it off on the back sides, so it really just starts at this and just goes up from there. So here's how I might play this game a little bit. It's kind of a tricky one in terms of thinking about it. It's pretty good. Well, I can think about it this way. I'm going to try turning those both off for right now. We're going to play with some different variations on this. Okay. Turn that one off too.
Which view are you in, sir?
Oh, I just did the main 3D view.
Oh, okay.
The default 3D view.
Yeah.
Okay. One strategy is something like this, where it's just all flat going up like that, and that's actually not too bad. The only disadvantage of this strategy is that now it's a little short where that door is.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that may not be the best thing, but we can sort of play with that. Another strategy would be, we could say, let that be the slope-defining line, and let this one follow it. Then it's all a little bit higher, so the walls are a little higher. We might have to attach some walls because it'll be a little higher than 8 feet right there. But again, that's not too bad. It's fairly clean. If I was going to keep this strategy, I would take that and attach it. Super. So that's a way to do it too. But I want to look at sort of where you were going because I think there is something to that strategy. We could say, okay, let's attach that. So again, these are just sort of very simple roofs. If I want to try something a little more exotic though, I think you were onto something. It just sort of resolved funny on the corner there. So if I did this, if I said that is sloping, and I didn't mind this sloping so much. I think what the problem we get into is where this front one slopes back, because that's really how you get that. It's almost like this funny crease in it. So I might think about doing something like this. And again, this is all strictly just architectural playing around. I might go ahead and turn this one off. Okay. And what I sort of want to do is turn that one on. Okay, but here's the deal. when I turn that one on, it makes that really funny fold on the other side. I think you probably looked at this and said, okay, now that's kind of weird. So I like the idea of having this little kind of gable on the front. It kind of welcomes you to the door. Mm-hmm. Messed up my backside there.
Yeah.
So what you can do in a case like that is, let's see if I can get this to work. Let's look at it straight up and down. Come over here. Let's try this. What if I could actually split this line on the side so part of it went up and part of it didn't go up? And what I would do is I'd split it right there evenly so that, I'm not sure if it's gonna work, but I'm willing to try anything. I'm gonna try just splitting it right about there and say, okay, you aren't gonna slope, but the front part is gonna slope. I just wanna see if that can do any good. No? Well, that's fine, let's see that. Can't join there. Can't make that roof, okay, no worries. It's can't quite do what I wanted to do, but I'm gonna sort of give it a little help. What's the problem is it's just having trouble with making this work. So what I'm gonna do is ever so slightly change it. See if this works. It may work, it may not. I'm always just sort of playing. And then when it doesn't work finally, I'm gonna show you how to do it as two steps that will work definitely. I'm trying to see if I can do it in one step. If not, it's okay. Maybe I'll make you like 1 foot one. It's kind of a cheat. See if it'll do that. Nope, still can't. Okay, no worries. I'll be sorry I went down this whole rabbit hole in a minute, but that's okay, we'll make this work. Okay, here's what you can do in that case, is as follows. Sometimes when you're trying to make a roof and you sort of have a complex condition, it makes sense to actually make the roof in two parts. And let's show you what I mean. So I got this roof over here, your big sweeping roof for the arched part. And what I can almost do is just trim. I'll do a little trim action. I'm gonna trim this and just put a roof over that section. Okay, and let me kind of get rid of all this other stuff. Okay, now, that roof's a good looking roof. It does what it's supposed to. Mm-hmm. For this front part over here, let me kind of change it around a little bit. Let's say, what if I actually made that out of a separate piece of roof? Okay, this is where again, this is a funny plate where we're playing with a building modeling tool, but actually we're sort of doing the architecture now. Okay, we'll say great. Let's go ahead and still give it, you give it a 1 foot overhang on both sides?
Yes.
Okay, super. But I'm gonna do this a little bit different. I'm gonna trim this so that it's shy of that one. Okay, I'll trim that. So I'm really making a separate piece of roof. And what I'm going to do is on this side, turn off that, say goodbye to you, and make that. Let's take a look at it. Oh, I'm in 3D. Just can't tell. Okay, now, you see that's not quite right just yet. How do you feel about this roof over here? Do you want it to kind of slope down to the front, or do you want it to kind of be flat at the front? If we'd have it either way, which way do you think about it better? For this front face over here, for this face right here, do you want that to be straight up and down, or do you want it to slope down the way I have it right now? I can do it either way.
I like the way it is right now.
Okay, so then the issue is, okay, I got this one roof, I have that other roof, and they're just not together. You say, well, that's not very good. How can I fix that? They have this fantastic tool, it's called the roof join tool. And let me find it up there, it is right up here. And what it lets you do is this. You can choose that, and you can say, it's gonna start with select an edge at the end of the roof that you wish to join or unjoin. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is basically just select one of these edges, and then it says, you're basically supposed to select a plane. Oh, that's interesting. Is it because of the height? Make this smaller. I think it must be going up too tall. Gonna make you shorter. Do you miss? You should be good. I think you should be good. Let's try this again. Join. Still missing it. Why is it missing? I gotta think about why that is. Then I'll stop playing around with this because somehow this is getting to be a rabbit hole that I didn't want to get into. Okay, where are you? You look good there. You look good there. You should join. What's happening to you? Is that it's too short? Put it up just a hair. Oops, I'm just raising it up a hair. I'm trying to figure out if it's the set. They're physically just missing each other. Something like that. Let's try that now. Part of the root to be joined misses the target face. I don't think about that. I'm not sure. I'm trying to figure out why that is, because I don't think it does. But I don't know. Yeah, I won't belabor it now. We'll sort of solve it. But your roof is fine. I just think it's a little funky in there. Let's try this. I'll try it with a slip. Okay, that did it. It just doesn't like the slope going back. I'll think in just a minute about why having the slope coming back sort of messes it up. So, that's not too bad. Okay, in that case, I would just lower that down. Let me put it back down to zero. I think this is just my messing around. I think it'll still join. Very good. And then I would attach this one here. Hello there.
Hi, just
come. Welcome. Oh, no worries. Okay, so that would be perfectly reasonable in terms of doing something like that. But again, just sort of think about what you want to do with that. That's my only comment about the architecture, is kind of thinking about that. But then super in terms of, let's look at your 3D views. And we're just looking at assignment one, just kind of talking through different people's approaches to it. So, okay, I think your floor plans were looking great. That's all super. You got the dimensions, you got the tags, that's all fine. This is all looking good. Tell me about your 3D views. So you have 3D views just from different angles?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay, looking good. So those are all named, we've duplicated them so we can copy them all to sheets. Super. One other thing, just as long as we're in here looking at this, let's go ahead and say, oh, for example, you see in some of the video stuff, camera views, and like how to set those up. And we could put cameras in here and get nice 3D perspectives too. At any point we can say 3D view, and there's the standard default 3D view, that's the one where you orbit around the outside, but for a camera, all you do is go through and sort of outside the crop zone right now, but over here, you choose a place, you pull the camera back to what you'd like to see, okay, and there's a camera view. Now, this is a little close in right now, okay? So if you want to, you can take this little wheel and do this. You can walk it back, oops, hang on, rewind. If I'm going to walk, I'll warn you, there's a little circle that shows up. That's our point of view. And if you go behind the circle or under the circle, you'll back up just a hair. If you're very far ahead or behind it, you'll go very fast. Okay? So that's one way to look at it. Maybe I can look over to the left or to the right. Okay? That's a pretty nice view in terms of looking at something like that. We'll just shade that.
Let's see. Thank you.
Okay. Similarly, we can go through and kind of put cameras wherever you like. So if you want to get a camera from the back, or a nice camera view sometimes is a camera view inside, right here. We'll sort of say right when you enter the door, what does the space look like? Now, the camera is it goes back as far as I click here. So if I go too close, it'll clip off the back of the camera. So pull on out. And now we can sort of just take a look at how this is. Let's look it around. Super. And good check. Okay, so you have that. So you are all ready to go ahead and save this away. When you put it on sheets, how'd you do? So you got the floor plan view looking good. Okay. This is actually nice to have the roof and the floor plan together. It's kind of an interesting one to sort of think about this. Just a small thing about how people will do this sometimes is they'll take this and say, it's kind of good to get the roof and the kind of floor plan in sync with each other. So think about how you might do that. Like, one way we might take it is over here, if I crop this a little shorter, I can activate it. And then maybe just pull that closer in. Like, I'm going to ignore the property lines because I think we sort of understand the property lines are there. Just get close to your house, close to your building. So I have that one. I'll do the same thing over to this one down here now. Well, that's interesting. I didn't know you could get both of them. Back over here, I'll edit the crop on this one. And the reason to get the closer crop is just this. And this is like one of these like fine points about just laying out the drawings. Okay, I got these two different views. What I'm going to do is actually I'm going to delete them both. I'm going to take them off the sheet just so I can get the title bars to kind of rejoin where I want them to be. So just temporarily, kind of get rid of that one. And then we're going to come back in, put it back in here again. Get the roof plan. And the only reason, I've been playing this game is so you can do that. You can line them up side by side, or you might be able, some people like to line them up one over the other. Both those are considered to be nice views because then, as you look at it, you know, it's easy for your eye to track and find a follow everything. That's looking pretty good. Okay. Another nice thing we could even put on this A1 sheet, just to kind of complete it, is you have these nice door and window tags, kind of showing where the doors and the windows are and all that kind of stuff. So it's kind of cool to put the schedule on the same sheet just so that as you see, oh, A, B, B, and kind of really do that. So that's a real easy thing to do. If you have that, like, sort of door schedule or window schedule, we'll just drag it on. And I'll just put it right next to it over here. Super. Okay, even your room finish schedule, you put that nice schedule that has the room areas and the finishes. We'll put them all there. Okay. So that's a nice, you know, just action pad loaded with information kind of sheet that has a little bit of everything there. So that's kind of a nice way to present that. Let's see what else we got. We got our elevations. They're looking good, okay? That's all fine. This is that same thing. You might crop them a little bit to kind of get them to fit on there, but the alignment is really good, so you can sort of track it all around to see how things are going. And we have our nice aerial views, looking perfect, as many camera views, but you're looking great. So.
Wait, so these are camera views?
These are, actually, these are these ones. They're the 3D views that he created. So let's go through that again. For any of these views, what you can do is orbit it.
And just save it as its own.
Exactly, that's a nice looking view. Duplicate this. Okay, we'll say new 3D view.
And I think I missed this when you were using the camera view. Does it automatically save as a new view?
It actually does. It always creates these ones that says 3D view 1 and 3D view 2. But again, after you do that, go through and rename it. You can sort of rename this and say interior or exterior, whatever it is. Okay, and then you can drag those. So always think about this one, the one that has the 3D and the brackets on it. That's the default one. Think of that as the working one, that it keeps on changing, and as soon as you want to lock something, okay.
Create a new one.
Yeah, create it. Yeah, duplicate it. Okay. You are looking fantastic. Okay, so super, I think you're in great shape. Okay, let us go ahead in our last few minutes, let's take a look at assignment 2 and the hill, just so you sort of get a sense of what that is. Let's see what Roscoe did to the hill, and then we'll talk about, in general, what you do to the hill.
Since I actually like really need to leave at 1, all right. I have like a couple questions. Should I ask that after this or before?
Yes, I know.
Okay, the first one is how do I get the counter, the 8-foot counter that I need for my lab?
Oh, okay. Let's think about that. There is a counter part. I think, is it already loaded into the file?
It is, but...
Oh, it is.
They have a 6-foot and an 8-foot, I think.
Okay.
And you can stretch it if you need to. You can just kind of pull the little blue tag and make it as long or short as you need to. Yeah.
I have a question. So I'm trying to upload the file, I guess. So it says line
Okay, that's fine.
And
that's just the starting point model, so that's going to be good. Okay.
Is this fine?
Yes.
Is this supposed to be?
It's doing what it's supposed to be doing.
Okay.
What happens is some of my models that I put out there, starting points are from a couple years ago, and it's going to upgrade it to the latest version that you need.
But then I just did this, but then nothing came up.
Oh, let's see what happens. Okay, hold on that. Okay, what's the other question? Let's get them all out again. You know, we'll get you, okay, squared away there. There you are. Okay, super. Now you're actually good, and now go to the floor plan. All right, right there. Okay, super. Right above it. First floor. So double click there.
Okay.
And you are ready to start drawing.
Okay.
Okay, so we can start with the walls. And just starting to place things in there.
I just do it here.
Oh, yeah. Or have you seen the assignment yet?
No.
Oh, we'll get you started there. Okay, hang on. We'll get you going in a second. Okay. What's your other question there?
No, I realized I didn't need it answered, so I'm good. Thank you.
Okay. In general, as you start, and we'll get you started on assignment 1 in just a second here. For this one, in terms of assignment 2, let's just take a look at it. The idea is in this, you have a two-story space that you're going to create for this little vacation house, and you're on this little hillside. Okay. And hillsides are kind of okay. We can kind of talk about how you create hillsides and things like that. But in general, you design this very much like you would design a one-story house. It's just that you have the issue where when you cut into the hillside, you want to cut away the earth because you don't want the earth inside your house. So let's just kind of show you that real quickly, just so you can have a sense of that. And then we'll get you started on 1. Okay, then Roski, thank you for lending us your example. Okay, so here's how it basically works. If I go to, I'll go back out. I'm gonna say visibility graphics. I'm just gonna show the site right now. I think we have the topography hidden. Super. I hate that thing. Okay. So this is a site, and basically, if we were going to go through and draw the walls, like we were going to kind of start designing and thinking about the lower portion of the house, I would start by just sort of putting some walls out here, going to be at lower level. That's going to be fine. I usually go up to upper level, just so we have that height in there.
That's if you have a second story.
Yeah, and for this one, you're probably going to go for, a two-story house. And I'll do like a 10-inch concrete wall. Okay, and I will just draw some little part that could be the beginning of a foundation level. Okay, let's take a look at that in 3D. So we're hanging out over here. Oops, I'm looking a little underneath it right now. Okay, super. So you'll see that in this house over here, the problem is the earth is kind of inside the house. And the way you fix that is there's this funny object called a building pad. But the building pad is really very useful. Think of it as a floor. Floors are very good, but floors don't actually cut away earth. Building pads actually cut away earth. So the nice thing is, if you put one in here, it'll actually not only sort of put a floor in, it'll cut the earth too. So you can go through and put in a building pad. And let's go into massing in sight. And this is like the only major difference you start getting into. We'll say we're going to pick the walls. This is kind of like what we do with floors. I usually do the building pad to the outside edge so that it'll also cut away the earth where the concrete walls are. Okay, super. And then for the height of the building pad, this is always kind of an interesting thing. I usually put it a little bit below the floor level so that It's actually, oh, think of it as the gravel underneath the slab, or think of it as something that got scraped away and you're going to build your floor on top of it. You really want a proper finished floor on top of that for your furniture to sit on. Okay, so that's why it's a little bit lower.
So you're saying, so the floor isn't like 6 inches above even.
Exactly.
Basically.
So
okay.
you want to put the pad low so that when you put your floor in, the floor is where it belongs,
right,
and the pad's underneath it. Now, building pads, just so that I'll get this more out here together, they actually sort of, what?
You said -6 inches is what,
yeah,
you put?
Yeah, I put it around 6 inches. That's because I'm going to put like a 6-inch slab on it or top, something like that. The building pad actually can extend further, just so you sort of know. Like, for example, I could bring it out if I want to. And if I do that, let me sort of show you what it does. It basically cuts away the earth inside, and when you're above the hill, it actually fills in the earth underneath it. Okay, we need to put some retaining walls in there, but you could actually have things that are built on the hillside, and yeah, it just gives you a level playing field, okay, for building on top of. Okay, so as you get going into two, just think about that. And then even as you get going into two and you start thinking you have a two-story house, let me show you this trick, and then you can run on out of here. You say that I have all these beautiful walls I put on level one. They are looking pretty good. Let me copy them. I'm going to paste them aligned to upper level. Okay, and now I have level two right above it. Okay, and just that little bit will get you started in terms of thinking about a two-story house versus a one-story house. Okay? Okay, so you head on off and have some fun. Mr. Roscoe, you are good, I think, relative to assignment one. I think you're good in terms of what we did here today in class today, because that's really what I would have done with the interactive grading. Okay, so just kind of clean that up in terms of like feeling good about it, and then upload that. Okay, and then I'll answer some questions.
Okay.
But I think we're in good shape. Okay, and then for assignment two and stuff like that, you're actually looking like you're pretty good here. Are you close to wanting to take a look at that one?
Yeah.
Okay, then.
I haven't tagged or any of that stuff.
Okay, nice.
And the one, like, question.
What's your question?
I wasn't really able to follow along that well, but how do you lower the walls so that you can't see the layer?
Ah.
So, like, just the edge?
Sure. Okay. Do you have an example of it on the back side here somewhere?
Right on the very front, and then on the left-hand side. For some reason, on the right-hand side, it's not there.
Let's talk about this. So here's the deal. You got a wall up here on the second floor. You have a floor underneath, okay, and then you have that. So usually, if you want to cover that up, what you end up doing is this wall above, what I'll do is I'll take that, and you can also put what's called a base offset on the wall. And if this floor is like a foot thick and I want to cover it, what I'll do is I'll say on the upper wall, I'll take the base and I'll lower it a foot. So I'll say,
thank you so much.
Take care. Doc, see you next week.
Yeah.
Okay, let's say -1 and see if that covers it.
So stay over left.
That could be true.
Is
it
okay?
Because the lower one goes up too high? We'll figure it out. Where does the lower one go to? The lower, yes. Oh, they do. Oh, okay. What's going to happen here ultimately is when we really start detailing it, yeah. What's happening is, yes, the top of this wall is overlapping with the bottom of that wall, okay? And that's kind of okay. Ultimately, we're going to join them together and that intersection is going to disappear.
Okay.
Okay, but we can do that together.
Okay. And
then, as a starting point, yeah, just lower them down like that. So
and then the wall on the right part, I can lift that up.
So which is this? This is on the right hand side?
Yes. Or just right, like on top of the deck, like you can still see it. So I can raise that up, right?
Which wall are you talking about?
The one you have highlighted right now.
That one?
Yeah,
oh.
Just on the very far right.
So what are you thinking about doing? Just kind of
just
show me with your fingers.
Right here, I want to pull that up so you can see, you can't see that left line.
Oh, there. Okay, let's see where that is. That usually gets into just sort of the relationship between the floor and the wall. Okay. So in that case, if it is there and it is there, and they're really right in the same place. Oh, I see. And they really are exactly in the same place. What we'll typically do with this is actually end up, we'll think about the relationship in terms of whether that floor, right now they're just perfectly aligned with each other and they're overlapping, which isn't quite right. It'll either be, if the wall is gonna come up to the bottom of the floor, it'll overlap. If the floor is gonna stay inside the wall, so you'll have a little lip of wall around the outside edge of the deck, we'll kind of bring the floor black back. The easiest way to fix this, though, at this point, is do this. You'll go through, in fact, it's really kind of what we do in general with this whole thing. We'll take this wall right here, and we'll say attach the top of it, and attach it to the floor.
Attach top to base?
Yes, or attach top base, and then click on the floor. And what you'll see happens is it goes up and then it stops right at the bottom of the little floor slab. So given the way you have the floors, we can do the same thing with the front over here. It's like I'm just going to go through and grab that front wall and I'll say under modify, attach top base, and then click on the floor above it.
Oh, okay.
And now what you're basically saying is that floor laps over it.
Got it.
Then we can think about coming in. Okay, let's get you going.
Okay, so how do I make it, so this is a center.
Yes.
500 square feet?
Yes.
How do I put that in? Okay. Or is that the starting point?
That is. What happens, okay, we'll throw this. Okay, we'll show you as you go, kind of Roscoe's. So you sort of get a sense of really what it is.
So you want like a garage for assignment two? Do I just put a pad and then cover it with a little roof? And
yeah.
That's basically it?
That's it. That's a carport.
Okay. Right.
That's good.
Okay.
So you're going to come up with a design for 500 square feet of what it could look like on that site. So that's just kind of the basis of, you know, kind of what it will look like or where you can build it. But then if we look over here, let's take a look at a couple of them. There is, show you here's Bruna's. Let's see what this one looks like. So, zoom the fit over here.
Thank you.
No worries, take care.
Are we getting the same thing next week?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
So, this is like 500 square feet. This is an example of what it could look like. You can sort of see there's kind of main meeting room area. There's a little conference room off to the side, a storeroom, and a little bit of a counter here. And then a bathroom over on this side. So that was one way to approach it. Okay. And what Roscoe did was a little different. His was, and everyone's going to be different, so that's going to be okay.
Oh, cool. And it's just for a bunch of researchers.
Yeah. So think about it, if there were three or four like you were out working at Jasper Ridge during the day, and it's kind of hot, you need a place to get out of the sun and kind of crunch some data. And you probably won't be there day in and day out, but it's kind of a place to go check in and check out your equipment so you don't have to haul it over and just kind of get out of the sun, use the restroom.
Do we have to put on a roof?
It's generally, let's think about that it should be sheltered so that, it could be enclosed so like even in the event of a rainy day or something like that, you can get out of the elements.
Yes.
Okay, so this is just another vision of what it could look like. So Roscoe's is more like kind of this rounded shape, but very open. So you sort of get a sense of it. His is kind of just like overall a big room with the entrance here. He has his lab bench just kind of on the side, three desks, storage, bathroom. Okay. So it really starts with this kind of coming up with an idea, just sketching a concept of what you have in mind, and then just going through and within the building tool, putting in the walls and the doors and the windows and kind of building it up.
Okay. I think my thing is I just don't know how to use
Revit. Okay.
And so I just don't know how to the design.
Sure.
Yet.
I think a good place to start, have you watched any of the videos yet?
Yes.
Okay. There's the second or third one where you just sort of just put down walls and doors and windows and all that. That's a good starting point for just how to. Okay. Try going through that in terms of just getting started with, you know, the basic procedure. In terms of how to approach designing something like a 500 square foot station, how about this? Why don't you even just do some sketching of, like, you know, what you think it might look like? And if you want to, let's set up a time, just tell me, and we'll just meet, and we can go through just translating what you've drawn into like getting some of it on paper,
okay.
All right, into the model.
Okay.
Because it's the hard part is just getting started. At first you look at it, and there's so many choices, and it's like, oh my God, where do I go?
Right.
But it's not that bad.
Okay. So like I shouldn't get my head wrapped around like all the numbers. And
not just yet.
Okay.
It's really, all those numbers are really just a design prompt that sort of is basically getting you a space that looks like that. So if you can think about just in terms of a big workroom, like no one's measuring everything precisely. It's all just sort of a sense of how big a space is. And just so you get a sense of how big a space is, 500 square feet, so you know, this is about 25. The total space, it's not as big as you think. Like 500 square feet is kind of from here over to there. So if I cut off a room here, that's all it is.
Oh,
so,
it is small.
Yeah, it's pretty small. So
is this 500 that they've given us?
Oh no, that's a whole site. So you can put it anywhere on there. That's like the boundary that your house should, or your building should stay within.
Okay. So
think about
somewhere.
Yeah.
Like in here.
Yeah. So that like one where it's sort of 20 by 25 or 18 by 30,
it's
somewhere in there.
All right. Yeah. I like the idea of just kind of drawing it on paper.
Yeah. Oh, it's an easier way to get started.
Yeah.
And then after you have that, then we can go through and translate that into Revit.
Okay. Sounds good.
Okay. Very good. Let me stop this, and we'll start with Ms. Harami.